Tonight, Hurricane Maria has been upgraded to a Category 3 storm, threatening areas that are still coping with the devastation brought by Hurricane Irma a fortnight ago. Nemo concerned about the failure of some to heed official warnings to stay indoors. The island's tourism minister lays fears of taxi drivers that rehabilitation work on the Castries Harbour will affect their livelihoods. And the Prime Minister accuses the opposition of double standards after the criticism of his decision to accept prisoners from islands affected by Hurricane Irma. A very good evening to you. Welcome to the Monday edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Polio. Our top story, Hurricane Maria, a Category 3 storm, will hit the Leeward Islands on the edge of the Caribbean Sea Monday evening, forecasters say, threatening areas that are still coping with the devastation brought by Hurricane Irma a fortnight ago. Predictions call for it to pass straight over Puerto Rico on Wednesday. Significant strengthening is forecast during the next 48 hours, and Maria is expected to become a dangerous major hurricane before it moves through the Leeward Islands, the National Hurricane Center says. A hurricane warning, meaning hurricane conditions are expected to strike, has been issued for the islands of Guadeloupe, Dominica, St. Kitts, Nevis, and Montserrat and Martinique. A tropical storm warning is in effect for Antigua and Barbuda. Puerto Rico and the neighboring British Virgin Islands and U.S. Virgin Islands are under hurricane watch, meaning hurricane conditions are possible within 48 hours. The eye of Hurricane Maria is forecast to pass over the center of Puerto Rico on Wednesday. Unlike Irma, which took a relatively flat westward angle as it raked Barbuda, St. Martin, Cuba, and other islands, and stormed toward the Florida Keys, Maria is expected to take a sharper northwest track, passing east of the Turks and Caicos as it heads toward the Bahamas. Maria puts many of those same areas at risk, including the Virgin Islands, parts of which were hit by Irma's eye wall before the storm veered north. The different approach also means that Puerto Rico and other islands that suffered only glancing blows from Irma could now be directly confronted with hurricane conditions. The National Emergency Management Organization is extremely concerned about the failure of some people to heed official warnings to stay indoors in anticipation of the passage of Hurricane Maria. Don Nicholas has the details.
The National Emergency Management Organization noted that despite an appeal to the public to stay indoors until an all-clear has been given, persons were still seen roaming the streets or venturing out to sea. The organization warned that these practices could put the lives of the perpetrators and those of others at risk.
This is a very significant challenge that we have. We need to discuss and to agree on how we're going to address that particular situation. It's very disturbing that the information would have gone out early enough and you still have persons just blatantly disregarding the advisories and still going about as if it's business as usual.
Nemo wishes to remind the public that weather systems can change drastically in record time, and if citizens are caught in the wrong place at the wrong time, it could spell disaster.
I think we just had the case of Irma. We had previous cases that would prove to people that you really need to take heed. Yesterday we had a discussion on Hurricane Tomas. It developed very, very quickly. So you never know what is going to happen, what is going to come out of these systems. Yesterday we were tropical storm warning. Today we're already under hurricane warning. We need to take heed of the advisories and we need to make sure that we do as we're told.
The National Emergency Management Organization is hoping that in future, persons will heed the warnings. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Acting Prime Minister Leonard Montout ordered all schools, businesses and government offices in St. Lucia closed today as a result of the effects of Tropical Storm Maria. They were to remain closed until the all-clear was given, but at least one businessman chose to open his doors anyway, saying that he was providing an essential service. Alex Busque has his story.
Managing Director of Jean-Marie and Sons, Evaristus Jean-Marie, says he has an obligation to render a service to his clients. He planned to remain open until the weather took a turn for the worst.
Well, I suppose the main reason is that it's very easy for us to deploy and employ staff to work at this time. As you see, I am getting involved personally. I have my brothers as well. So if anything, weather threatens, it's easy for us to just shut down the station and be in a safe place. And the same could be said of the few members of staff over there. But clearly there is a demand for providing the service because we've had quite a few motorists coming for fuel. And I don't think any gas station is open. So
Mr. Jamari says he also has an obligation to protect his staff, the business and himself.
I think we're helping in the situation, but we are very mindful that the impending storm, and if things really threaten, we can easily disengage our services and protect our staff and ourselves.
Even when the country is shut down for good reasons, as in this instance, Mr. Jamari says there is a great loss of revenue.
Well, clearly, if the country is shut down, there is a loss of productivity, a loss of output, and it is a cost. As to how much it is, I don't know, but I'm sure an exercise can be done.
But do you think it's being done?
I don't think it's being done, but there is a cost when you shut down. People are not working, they were not producing. There is a cost, and I don't think it's too much difficult an exercise to do.
Mr. Jamari says it is something that may be worth looking into. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Buske.
And with the announcement of an island-wide shutdown due to the passage of Hurricane Maria by acting Prime Minister Leonard Motut, a local businessman believes although the closure seems to be bad for the economy, the nation will make up for the financial loss and bounce back. Sheffield Gillard explains.
Businessman Michael Chastney says naturally, when a country is shut down for whatever reason, there will be a cost to the economy. Acting Prime Minister Leonard Montooth made the call to shut down the island pending the passage of Hurricane Maria. The veteran businessman could not put a dollar value on the expected loss to the country, but says the closure has to be measured against what could happen if businesses were allowed to operate as usual.
I don't know exactly what percentage, but a large percentage of people who work at the hotels and the supermarkets come from outside. So that means they have to come up from the coast. So they have to traverse the road. With that kind of wind that you're looking at here now, there could be broken trees and people could get affected. So you have to weigh up the costs of closing the country down versus the human life. And that's a thin line. Nobody's perfect in life, but when governments make a decision, they have to think what can be. Because at the end of the day, you can really look at it that, well, you know, the decision was made, no lives were lost, a couple thousand dollars may be lost. But whatever is lost today will be gained tomorrow because the sales will be there.
According to Mr. Chastney, St. Lucia is a small country with a limited number of businesses, so what was lost today will be regained tomorrow. His concerns, however, is the farmers.
That is my worry, because if that wind affects the bananas there, that would really set us back a bit. But I think the wind seems to be to the north, mainly from what I've seen. They know that the hurricane season is on and that, you know, all their hard work could come to zero if something happens. But I'm hoping and praying that we'll be spared. It's a lot to ask for, but I'm hoping that we'll be spared and the banana industry will survive because St. Lucia really needs that industry.
Hurricane Maria is expected to pass over the island Monday evening. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
We continue the broadcast with news that with the outer bands of Hurricane Maria expecting to produce heavy showers, gusty winds and thunderstorms, St. Lucians were being warned today to not only take precaution, but to pay attention to only official updates from NEMO and the Met Office. NEMO has repeatedly expressed concern about the circulation of inaccurate or false information on social media. Don Nicholas reports.
St. Lucia was placed under hurricane warning on Monday. The island is expected to experience weather conditions associated with Hurricane Maria.
St. Lucia has been placed under hurricane warning, so we are no longer under tropical storm warning. Right now, we are under a hurricane warning. What does that mean? It means that there is the potential for St. Lucia to receive hurricane conditions from the system. So again, we need to make persons understand that we're under hurricane warning.
NEMO cautioned the public about spreading inaccurate information. The organization noted that because heavy overnight showers had subsided, followed by a calm period, some persons were on the social media saying that the system had passed, when in fact, it has not arrived. Some persons were also paying attention to information from NEMO in other islands rather than NEMO St. Lucia.
We got a lot of calls this morning because you would recognize that we had some rain and wind last night and we had a calm this morning, and persons were saying that the brunt of the system has passed. It has not reached us and we are on the hurricane warning right now.
NEMO also wishes to advise the public that if necessary, emergency shelters across the island will be opened. They can be identified by the red symbol.
We also have our shelter managers that are also on standby, that if persons would like shelters open in specific areas, we can facilitate that as well. We have not had any requests for opening of shelters.
Small craft operators and other marine interests were told to remain in port and secure equipment. Persons are urged not to venture out till the all clear was given. Residents and motorists in areas prone to flooding and landslides were advised to be vigilant and exercise extreme caution. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Still in the first segment of the broadcast, Street Vibes.
Hi, I'm Alex Buske and you're watching Street Vibes. Today we're asking people in this inclement weather, what are you doing in town?
I'm just walking in town to see what's happening in town.
Are you that curious?
Because I want to know what's happening. I want to see what's happened.
Okay, so far what have you seen?
I haven't seen anything wrong in town. Okay. The only thing I like is that a lot of people keep the place closed like the government said.
So you'll be heading home soon?
Very soon, because I don't live far from here.
I've just come to the bakery there, which is still. I was going to be open to buy flour. Okay. So they tell me they're closed. I'm going back. So we're going in the country and buy.
Just walking in town.
Are you that curious?
No, not that.
So why? Well, what are you really doing in town? Everywhere is shut.
Just walking.
Just walking.
Yes.
What are you doing out?
I just walking to come and see what's happening, and then I going back home now because the weather is start getting I like the weather again. So I going back. I just wanted to see what's happening in town.
You're just curious.
Yes, that's just curiosity. Yeah, man. That's the only horse in town.
I'm just going home. I'm in town. I live in town, so I'm just going home.
Yeah. But why are you walking around?
Just to see what's going on.
You're curious?
Yes. And helpful as a scout.
Well, you heard them. You've just been watching Street Vibes with me, Alex Buske, down here at the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Street. With that, we'll take you right back to our studio.
Thank you very much, Alex. You are watching St. Lucia's television and news leader and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5. We are also online at the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. Still to come, St. Lucia begins experiencing the effects of Hurricane Maria and local farmers very concerned about the potential impact of the storm on their crops.
This segment is brought to you by Sagicor Finance. Sagicor Finance, wise financial thinking for life.
Welcome back and thank you so much for staying with the DBS News World. As Hurricane Maria bore down on the islands, rough seas generated by the storm were expected to begin affecting the island with waves and sea swells anywhere from 12 to 17 feet. Small craft operators, local fishermen and beach users were warned to stay in port. Alex Buske has more.
All across the island, including the Castries Harbour, there were signs of the storm's power and what might happen as the weather system intensified. The tides have only begun to rise, and now you could see all the debris already in the streets. If this gets any worse any time later, the streets may be impassable. The city remained closed, and Jeremy Street vendors took heed this time around, adhering to the weather advisory and staying out of town. Others chose to protect their city as best as they could.
Well, I'm just passing around to see what's going on in my city. We should make sure everywhere, all the drains and things are cleared, everything. But so far, everything's good. But there are some of them open this morning, they make some of them close. And there are some other stores open around the area, but not much stores. But everything so far is great.
What if the drains are not cleared? What would you do about it?
Well, some of the drains have certain situation, but the government didn't leave it yet. But so far, everything good. The mayor's doing a good job so far.
As bad as the weather was predicted to get, some left their loved ones at home and set out to earn a living.
As we know that we're getting hurricane, we just put a few things in the house, drink the water or electricity, about the food. But at the same time, we have responsibility to work. So I just try to go work and just do the business. And anything, I can just rush to my home and then take care of my families.
So far you're going to work?
Yeah, so far I'm going to work.
The waves on the Vigi beach were pounding the shores on Monday afternoon as the wind speed increased. Not exactly the time for a picnic.
And the advisory also warns sea bathers and small craft owners, check that out. Use your initiative or do the smart thing. Stay ashore. Stay at home.
For the DBS News World, I am Alex Busquet.
And now this. Councillors of the Castries Constituencies Council and the City Police patrolled the capital and its environs today, assessing the early effects of Hurricane Maria on St. Lucia. Councillors were checking for potential hazards, while the City Police ensured that citizens heeded warnings to stay indoors.
In spite of the country's shutdown, but we as the official of the City Council have to move around if there is no danger to see exactly what is happening. We have already visited our mayor and Councillor Ditoville, myself. We have moved around, even reached by Shock Bay, moving around to Fulasho. At the moment, there's nothing too serious, but of course, as you know, when they give the clearance, then that is the time where we'll be able to know exactly, even by tomorrow, how we're able to clean the city and make sure that everything is all right.
On more than one occasion, officers had to encourage people to go home for their own safety.
What happened is that a lot of people don't abide by what you call law and order. And unless some disaster, something very serious, that's the time everybody wants to blame government and blame all authority. And this is why today we as the councillors moving around to see that the vendors don't vend around and make sure that until they get the clearance, that nobody will vent around the city.
Thankfully, councillors say city vendors also took warnings seriously and stayed away. Local farmers are hoping for the best but preparing for the worst today as Hurricane Maria strengthened into a major Category 3 hurricane. While the island would not take a direct hit from the storm, it was expected to dump several inches of rain on St. Lucia.
The Bexar community over the years has suffered tremendous flooding damage as a result of severe weather systems. With Hurricane Maria expected to pass over the island today, one farmer who lost 7 cows as a result of the Christmas Eve trough was seen taking measures to safeguard their property and livestock, hoping that they would be spared from the system.
We just have to prepare for everything because we always get in flooding. No matter what, once the little rain pass, we'll get flood no matter what. So we're just getting prepared for everything.
Ms. Sulal, who also lost her crops last year as a result of the passage of Tropical Storm Matthew, says she and others like her got no assistance from government, not even to mitigate the flooding situation in the community.
Government never put no input to help us in anything, as we can see. The only thing they just give us is a little oil and just a little fertilizer. And that's the only thing. And up to now, everybody have been suffering the same way. Up to now, I have my bananas from last year for this year. It's hard for me to sell it. I'm not selling for the company as yet. I'm not selling. I'm only selling for 1-2 little black markets, and they cannot even give me boxes to do what I can do for them. And all the time, I'm at a loss, very big loss, because sometimes I have to cut around 150 bunches, just put them down. I cannot get to sell them.
With Hurricane Maria on its way, the farmer says she could not withstand another loss.
What I like them to do is to help the farmers do something. They always say they're going to help, and I'm not seeing no improvement as yet, nothing. Because up to now, I spent how many $1,000 put that bananas back on the field, and I cannot get that money now. I just losing it.
Last year, as much as 85% of farms were damaged as a result of Tropical Storm Matthew. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
In other news, beachside residents of Tapion say they are facing a terrible challenge from flooding whenever it rains. With Hurricane Maria threatening to dump several inches of rain on the island, they fear for the worst. Alex Busquet tells us more.
Homeowners at Lower Tapio Bay say just the overnight rains have already flooded their yards. It's a constant challenge they have to face as the water outlet is clogged with sea sand.
With Tapio at the bottom here, when you see it's raining, in terms of hurricanes and stuff like that, storms and things like that, it does always be kind of difficult of the because of the sea swells. Whenever you see the waves comes up, it back up and it sends all the water back into our area, as you can see. It's flooded there right now, and there's not much we can do. It was like that last week.
Mr. Stanislas says Lower Tapio Bay homeowners got some help dealing with the situation, but it has returned.
The ministry or whoever it is send backhoes and stuff like that to try and clear it out. They did. It worked for a bit, but now, right as you can see, it's started raining again, and it's more water. And there's not much we can do. We can just sit back and just watch and pray that things don't get to us.
The outlet for the backyard flood water is constantly clogged with sand that the huge waves push into the culvert, making it impossible for the water to flow freely. Resident of Tapio Bay, Eustace Stanislas, says the water in his backyard will not go away easily as the ground there is already saturated.
As you can see there right now, the water comes down from the hill, from Tapio, from the let's say, by police headquarters side there, and all that water comes down. Now that water expecting to go to the sea. That's the way out for the water. But since the sea is backing up right now, since the swells are so high, you find all the water comes back right up. And it don't clear out easily unless they don't unchoke the entrance. There is a backhoe that will have to come and try and clear out the entrance.
Until then, Mr. Stanislas says he and his neighbors are preparing for the worst. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Busquet.
In other news, with impending Hurricane Maria and the passing of Hurricane Irma, an 1,800-ton capacity barge carrying much-needed food and emergency supplies from St. Vincent and the Grenadines has offloaded in Tortola, the British Virgin Islands, after the rapid mobilization by the St. Vincent and the Grenadines government, farming community and the private sector. The rapid emergency response was coordinated by the Minister, Camilo Gonzalez, and Minister Sebastio Cesar, acting as the SVG government's official delegation to ensure the smooth flow of relief efforts to the British Virgin Islands. Speaking from St. Vincent and the Grenadines, Minister for Agriculture, Caesar, said that with approximately one-tenth of the British Virgin Islands population having a St. Vincent and the Grenadines connection, the government opened the opportunity to send personalized packages to family members and friends free of both shipping transport costs and export duties. OECS Director General Dr. Didikas Jewell said the community saluted this latest initiative of the SVG government, made possible in part by the OECS Agri-Shipping Initiative, and said more emergency supplies were continually being sourced across the OECS for both sea and air drops into the worst affected areas. The Ministry of Local Government recently held a consultation for local government officers in order to review legislation governing local government. The exercise was done in collaboration with the Attorney General's office. We hear more in this report.
The Local Government Authority is one that ensures that local authorities are efficient, transparent, democratic, accountable, and sustainable. On Thursday, September 14, 2017, the Ministry of Equity, Social Justice, Empowerment, Development, Sports, Culture and Local Government held a consultation for all local government officers. One major undertaking of the consultation is legislative review of St. Lucia's local authority system and to ensure that legislation is responsive to current issues. Donovan Williams is the Permanent Secretary in the Ministry of Equity, Social Justice, Empowerment, Development, Sports, Culture and Local Government.
So today's activity gives us an opportunity to engage them. They've had an opportunity to review the document. They hopefully will be coming to the forum armed with questions, clarifications, areas for consideration in terms of amendments. And we also will have within that forum the Office of the Attorney General represented to assist us in providing any clarification from a legal perspective and also to enhance the process of any amendments that may be required as a result of this engagement.
The workshop was held at the conference room of the ministry. reporting from the Ministry of Equity, Social Justice, Empowerment, Youth Development, Sports, Culture, and the Local Government, I am Chevre Marius.
When we come back in just a moment, taxi drivers worried about the impact of rehabilitation works at Port Castries on their livelihoods.
This segment was brought to you by Sagico Finance. Sagico Finance, wise financial thinking for life.
Welcome back and thank you so much for staying with us. Heavy rain usually causes flooding to parts of the Castries Southeast constituency, particularly in Mark and Bexhill, rendering several roads impassable to vehicles. Residents of the community say they are frustrated and want the flooding issues to be addressed once and for all. Sheffield Gellard reports.
Extreme rainfall events have left the fragile community helpless in the past. Numerous flood mitigation projects have been undertaken, but the problem still lingers. Residents of the Bexhill Mark community says they are walking on eggshells every time they experience bad weather. They want the problem to be addressed once and for all.
Every time them fellas come in that river, there's just scratch by the river side and them kind of thing. Them fellas need to move that silt in that river, either take some tractor, push this silt bridge to bridge and just excavate it and take it out from there and get it out of there. Send it someplace called the sack. They have places around there that need backfilling, put the gravel someplace else. But they just come in and just take that, send it, just scratch the river, just level out the bottom of the river, and that's it. And that's not good. They need to dig that deeper. Right now, they don't have no safety around here, because whenever the river come up, everything just go in there. So they need to, the main thing is dig that river. They need to dig that river and take out the silt in the river.
One resident believes others use the flooding situation for financial gain rather than safeguarding life and property.
Right now, we're concerned for people's lives here, but right now in Bexhill, when we get flood here in Bexhill, it's a money-making thing. Everybody looking forward for the backhoes and the truck to be working.
Jim Calix, who lives in the entrance of the Bexhill Mark Junction, says there is a small river behind his house which has not been dredged in a long time. He is extremely concerned.
When it rains, we seem to be the first person in the Ivy Mark Gap that gets flooded. And if you can take a close look, you can see we have dug this once. And they've been digging the rivers all around, except here. So you would like to know the reason why they're not being coming here to have this done. Because if you can look closely here, you see this morning it rained and the water came up here. And we had a little semi-issue. We have to be clearing stuff and things like that. So I'm asking the relevant authorities whether they can just come here, have a look at this river behind our house and get it clean for us. And we'll appreciate it.
Another long-time resident says the constant flooding leaves puddles of water in the area, which becomes a breeding ground for mosquitoes.
The water that's in the gutter, it is things that mosquitoes. That provide mosquitoes, a lot of mosquitoes. So the river got to dig. So long as not dig, nothing will be done.
The Bexhill Mark Flood Mitigation Risk Reduction was part of a package under the Natural Disaster Management Rehabilitation and Reconstruction Loan of $48.5 million to undertake the restoration of some of the infrastructure damage following Hurricane Thomas in 2010. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
In other news, Tourism Minister Dominic Fede sought to allay the fears of taxi drivers and other players in the industry who depend heavily on cruise arrivals that a two-month berthing facility renovation project at the Castries Harbour will not affect their livelihoods. Fede says the harbour will still be fully operational. Don Nicholas has the details.
With the peak season set to open in November, Tourism Minister Dominic Fede acknowledges that there could be some anxiety on the part of taxi drivers and other players within the industry concerning renovation works being undertaken at the Castries Harbour to accommodate expansion of the berthing facility. The minister says there is no need to worry. He says SLASPA and the Tourist Board have the situation under control.
SLASPA and the Tourist Board, they have a plan which would ensure that the other three berthing facilities in the Castries Harbour will be open and still be fully operational, so that the impact of the construction will be very, very, very small We are also working with a number of the cruise lines to do some anchorage outside of the harbor so that the opportunity for an expanded and sustained cruise performance will be there.
Once the new facility is opened, St. Lucia will be able to make room for a bigger cruise industry by accommodating larger vessels.
We will be able to host larger vessels, mega ships. We'll be able to double the capacity of some of the ships that are going to be calling at that particular facility so that we can see improved and increased numbers.
The new berthing facility is expected to be opened in January. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The Ministry of Equity, Social Justice and Empowerment, in collaboration with the OECS Secretariat, has undertaken the second phase of the multidimensional approach to poverty assessment. Multidimensional poverty is made up of several factors that constitute poor people's experience of deprivation, such as poor health, lack of education, inadequate living standard, lack of income, disempowerment, poor quality of work, and threat from violence. We hear more in this report.
From Monday, September 11th to Thursday, September 14th, 2017, the ministry held a series of workshops aimed at examining the quantitative and qualitative methodologies of poverty. Ms. Juliana Daniel Foster is the OECS project assistant.
So this training of trainers is preceding a research activity. For starters, they're learning all about multidimensional poverty. This approach started out with the Oxford University researchers belonging to an institute, OPHI, the Oxford Poverty and Human Development Initiative, and the UN has adopted it and partnered with them, and they've promoted it globally. So we've done the quantitative work as a region, as a sub-region, but this now is the qualitative aspect. The trainers will get to actually apply what they're learning now in a pilot research exercise.
The workshop provided guidance to participants on the issue of poverty. The participants engaged in discussion and group activities, which examined the different mechanisms for poverty reduction throughout St. Lucia. Social Transformation Officer and Welfare Officer for Canneries and Soufre, Danali Estava Sentange, had this to say.
This session helps us to assess. It helps us to be able to ask the questions that we want answered. Why are you poor? How did you become poor? But what is even more important than that is how can you get yourself out of poverty? What can we do? What can the institutions do? What can persons do? How do we come together and collaborate to get persons out of poverty?
As a result of this workshop, social workers and STOs are now better placed to discuss and plan strategies to reduce poverty throughout St. Lucia. Reporting from the Ministry of Equity, Social Justice, Empowerment, Youth Development, Sports, Culture and the Local Government, I am Chevere Marius.
Prime Minister Alan Chastney has taken a swipe at the opposition St. Lucia Labour Party after heavy criticism was levelled against him for agreeing to house overseas prisoners following the passage of Hurricane Irma. Here is Don Nicholas with more.
Prime Minister Alan Chastney denied reports that he was planning to house 40 high-risk prisoners from the British Virgin Islands. The Prime Minister said he has agreed to take in only 3 prisoners from the Turks and Caicos Islands. He came under fire for this decision. However, he recalls that in 2004, when Hurricane Ivan struck Grenada, the offer was made to house 20 prisoners here.
This is not the first time that St. Lucia has made this offer. If you recollect, there's some hurricanes in Grenada in which the same offer was also made. I know very well that the British government in particular, when we had Hurricane Thomas, were the ones that were here. And I know the work that they did. And we could not have made it through Thomas without their assistance.
Prime Minister sought to remind the critics that there are St. Lucians living in all the affected territories. He lamented that 120 prisoners have escaped in the British Virgin Islands.
I know that when you're in a bad shape, that have criminals going around. So for instance, there are 120 prisoners that escaped in the British Virgin Islands that have not been caught and are among the general public. Unfortunately, we're hearing about the disaster that's taking place in St. Martin. And a lot of that is being perpetuated by criminals who have also escaped. So the offer is on the table.
The Prime Minister gave the assurance that strict protocols would be adhered to in doing the transfer of the three Turks and Caicos prisoners, and that the security of St. Lucians would not be at risk. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The broadcast will continue in just a bit. Time now for the usual reminder. Hurricane Maria has been upgraded to a Category 3 storm, threatening areas that are still coping with the devastation brought by Hurricane Irma a fortnight ago. Nemo concerned about the failure of some to heed official warnings to stay indoors. The island's tourism minister lays fears of taxi drivers that rehabilitation work on the Castries Harbour will affect their livelihoods. And the Prime Minister accuses the opposition of double standards after the criticism of his decision to accept prisoners from islands affected by Hurricane Irma. And that's the broadcast. Thank you so much for watching and listening to the DBS News World. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Timothy Polian, wishing you a very safe Monday evening. Goodbye and see you next time.